WNYC-TV presents About the Arts with Barbara Lee Diamonstein.
Welcome to About the Arts. I'm Barbara Lee Diamonstein, and it's a very special pleasure for me today to welcome today's guests. On my right is Louise Nevelson, America's leading sculptor. She's also, to deal in superlatives, America's leading everything else you could think of, philosopher, glamour lady, pyrotechnician. And a lot of us have known that for a long time. Now, together with her collaborator-interviewer, Diana McCowan, they have contained Louise's special genius in this remarkable new book, Dawns Plus Dusks. Ms. McCowan has worked with Mrs. Nevelson for more than a dozen years, and she is a graduate of the Yale School of Fine Arts. A very warm welcome to both of you. Diana, how did you happen to do this book?
Well,
when did you start on it?
Oh, I started really in my head a long time ago, but I started probably physically 4 years ago on it. And I had read an interview that André Malraux did on Picasso, and I felt that since there was very little put down in paper about a genius as Picasso was, that maybe since we have a genius with us still, that we could put it on a two-dimensional sheet of paper and do something with it.
We certainly have. In this book, there are all sorts of, I guess, the wisdom and the wit of Louise Nevelson. One of the things that you've said is that from the beginning, one of the most important things in your life was to claim yourself totally. What does that mean, Louise?
Well, that means that you recognize your heritage, that you are born and you stand on your own 2 feet, and that you make your decisions and you live your life, and that you're not pulled out too much, that you have a center, and you are entitled to that. That's really your true heritage, not a lot of other things. And so I've pretty much lived that way, as much as I can.
You've also said it isn't how you live, it's how you finish.
Right. With that thought in mind, you know, you feel that you are living daily, that is encompassing your whole life. And therefore, I think what you will be doing all the time, from day to day, from minute to minute, you are more aware of your moves.
You certainly have been very aware of your moves and your art and your life. And for more than 40 years, you've known everyone, all sorts of distinguished people, particularly in the visual arts that include Rivera and Elshemius and Gorky and Dubuffet and Wildenstein, and you make reference to a wonderful story with Ellen Graves and Céline. How has that influenced your life and your art?
Well, I couldn't answer that because I didn't think they had that much of an influence over me. Because evidently all connections is living, and living, no doubt, does add something to your awareness. But since I'm not really a hero worshiper, I met them on a pretty even level.
What's it been like for you, Diana, to live under the same roof with Louise Nevelson?
Well, very simple. Very nice.
Oh, you can say something else.
What's the most significant
thing? It isn't so
thing?
Simple and it isn't so nice. It's exciting.
Well, yeah, that's later.
Well, tell us now, what's the most significant thing that you've learned living with Louise? Because it has been a rare privilege for you, as you've often said.
Well, that's an awfully difficult thing to answer. I would say, really, it's just the sort of to have enough courage to open up and do what you want to do, which seems an easy thing to say, but it's very difficult.
Louise, you've written and talked extensively about the influence of New York on your life. You've lived here for nearly 55 years.
Mm-hmm.
And you've said that the city has had a real influence on your work. What about this city makes you sing?
Well, I think it's just the whole city, and I could start and write a book on just that alone.
Well, maybe that'll be the second project.
Yes, because this city is utterly magnificent, really. And when you see it, no one quite realizes, but when you encompass the whole city, it becomes a great 20th century work of art itself.
Does the city have the same effect on you, Diana? You're not from New York originally.
Oh, no one's from New York originally. That's what I mean. It's the most creative city from that point of view. Everyone comes to New York like it's the center. And it still is.
Yes,
don't you think?
Yes, and by the same token,
they adopt New York because it has that vitality.
They are drawn to the city. And when you think of the creative minds in New York City, now take, for instance, we know about art, music, and the fine arts, but we forget, say, our hospitals and the scientists and the doctors that are constantly doing research, that alone opening up avenues. But there isn't you can't take from your left foot and take a step with the right and not realize that this is a teeming, vital, creative place.
You also mentioned in the book that if you talk about your childhood in Rockland, Maine, and obviously there are very strong ties, but you also make it quite clear that your creative juices have flowed in this city, and you make reference to people that you went to school with who still live in Maine and how different their lives are from yours in appearance and in production.
That's right. That is right. But I think that one has to have courage, really, and one must gamble with life to really move into the areas where they can fulfill themselves. Now, New York, for instance, is my mirror. Now, my mirror in Maine, I wouldn't quite like what I see. I couldn't have fulfilled myself. The thing is, you must remember that New York gives people a wide range. And if you have tremendous energies and tremendous desires and things, this is the place.
Well, it's said in that book as well, I think the exact quote is, "I don't like the safe way, it limits you."
Well, that's right. That is right.
There is something that you've both cited in the book as well that interested me particularly, and I'd like to try to recall. You said, "I've always thought that two dimensions, the flat surface, like in painting, is far superior to sculpture." Mm-hmm. And then later on you said, "It seems that I make all my work just to draw." I was very struck by that because the first thing that came to mind was, then why do you sculpt? Perhaps you could explain that.
Uh-huh. Well, now wait. You have to sculpt. Well, my things are not sculpture as such, but you have to sculpt to see the drawing. You see, you don't necessarily have to take a pencil or a pen or something and draw. There are many ways. Just, let's say, collage some of my work. Well, by using collage, that method, that already gives me my drawing, you see. And so that probably, I guess, no one has talked like this, but for me, it gives me my drawing. Because the nails and the holes in the nails and all the different, what would you say, when a car goes over a piece of wood and it comes out with all sorts of things, dents and things in it, those are my drawings. Well, what's the use of drawing them when it's much more direct doing it the way I do? It's immediate, it's true, and it's there.
But I've also heard it said, in fact, I read in another book about you, that you're more interested in product and conception than process. How does that fit in with this idea, and what does that mean?
Well, I don't think I've ever used
the term. An author wrote that about you.
Yes. Well, that you better go to the author and find out.
Well, we'll ask Arnold Glimcher, because I'm sure he has a good answer for that, and another very interesting book about you.
Yes.
in this book that is also filled with wonderful photographs. There are more than 100 of them, and many of them you've taken, haven't
yes.
you, Diana?
Yes.
Most of them.
Mm-hmm. You studied to be a photographer originally?
No, never, no. I always loved the camera, and I've studied not to be a photographer in that sense. And I've always had my own darkroom and printed pictures and just gone about with my camera in my hand and taking photographs. So.
What are some of your favorite stories, anecdotes in the book?
You mean personal ones that mm-hmm. have to do with taking
yes.
photographs?
No, but in this book, it's just such a range of material. It's a lifetime that's really condensed. It's distilled Nevelson that we're lucky enough to get within these hardcovers. There must be one or two anecdotes that strike you as being either very significant or very representative of Louise's philosophy or the way she leads her life and makes her art.
Mm-hmm.
Is there one or two that you could tell us about?
Well, it's hard to... Let me think a minute.
Well, you didn't put in that I washed my own floors and the stairs.
It is too. It's in there.
Part two.
Oh, it's in there. No, it's in there. No, I think really the fun of it was that it was taped at all different hours of night and day. And whenever we felt like it, half the time when it was being taped, I don't think Louise even knew the machine was on. And so it was done from such a candid,
sometimes,
but it was a familiar.
Drinking a little champagne in
between. Oh, indeed, indeed we were. So it was drunk, sober, 4 a.m. and 4 p.m. And even on the original tapes, there's cats meowing and the doorbell ringing and somebody saying, answer the phone quick, you know. So it had a great activity even from the beginning. That's why when I transcribed the tapes.
So it wasn't a self-conscious effort that this was going to be about.
Oh, never, never, never. And that's why I transcribed them myself, because I knew no one would understand what was going on. And to keep that beat and liveliness in it and livingness in it, then it had to be done as quickly as can be, you know, as quickly as she works, and she works very quickly.
John Kennedy has a very admiring introduction to the book.
Mm-hmm.
And there is something that he completely, and that you have managed to capture a true voice, an authentic Louise Nevelson mm-hmm. voice that is a distillation of a lot of living and a lot of thinking.
That's the best anecdote on the book. Now, John Kennedy came down about 3 years ago to take Louise and I for dinner, and Louise took them to Bellato's, I think. Mm-hmm. That's when mm-hmm. it started in. And I was sort of not feeling too well that evening, but I had started doing the tapes, and I had a transcription of one of them. And when he came in, he said, Diana, aren't you coming with us? And I said, no, I really don't feel up to it. I said, but I want to read you something. So I read him this tape that I had transcribed, and he said, oh, that's marvelous. He said, what are you going to do? And I said, well, I think I'll keep doing this, and maybe sometime I'll have a book eventually. I don't know. He said, oh, I think that's a great idea. So 3 years, 4 years go by, and I call up Kennedy, and I tell him that I have this book. And he said, fine, give me the name of your editor at Scribner's, and have them send me a copy. So he gets sent a copy. And I didn't hear anything. And I thought, oh no, you know, maybe I made a big mistake and this is going to be terrible. I was very nervous and twitchy. So finally, we get a letter. I'm over at the Scribner's and I'm talking with my editor, and she said, and we were putting photographs together for the book, and the telephone rings and it's Mr. Kennedy. And he calls up and he said, this is magnificent. It's wonderful. I'd like to write the introduction. I've been trying to call Diana all morning, blah, blah, blah. And my editor, Pat Crystal, said, well, Mr. Kennedy, she's here in the office. And I think my blood pressure must have gone up 200 points. I go in and I take the phone, and he says, oh, you know, he'd love to write the introduction. Everything's fine. And I said, you know, Mr. Kennedy, the only reason why I had the nerve to call you was because I promised you when you'd come down 4 years ago to take us to dinner that you'd be the first one to see. He said, oh, isn't that strange? He said, I don't remember anything about that.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Isn't that strange? That's really...
the accidental nature
exactly.
of things. But he certainly
exactly.
remembered about the book, because
oh,
he could
sure.
not be any more admiring than he is in this introduction, and that's certainly high praise.
Oh, it's a beautiful introduction.
And it's condensed, too. Mm-hmm. That's what I think is good.
How many pictures are in the book?
Is it 137?
At least that many. And it's pictures of you, Louise, mm-hmm. from her childhood mm-hmm. in Maine, her early life in New York, early drawings that you've done and photographs from all over the world, including almost a scrapbook in the back of your gang. Tell us some of the people that are contained in there.
Oh,
in the book.
Let's see.
In the photographs and things.
I just start with me.
Oh,
yes,
well,
Louise.
Naturally, madam.
And I remember seeing Jasper Johns.
Jasper Johns, Alfonso Osorio, John Cage, Barbara Lee Diamondstein, Merce Cunningham.
Robert Indiana.
Dorothy Miller, and yes. Giacometti. Well, they are in a photograph also about the Venice Biennale.
Yes, why don't you tell us about that particular photograph, because it's a particular...
It's a wonderful one, isn't it?
Not only an interesting photograph, it relates to a significant experience, mm-hmm. and it's 1952, is it, in Venice?
62.
Oh, no,
62, excuse
yeah.
me, at the Biennale.
Yeah. Yes.
Why don't you tell us about that experience?
Well, I was asked by the Museum of Modern Art to represent them, and we decided to go. Actually, we went a couple of weeks ahead of time because of the work that we have to do. And we became very good friends with Giacometti and all the other people there. But the greatest joy of all was that I was working with the Italian workmen, and not knowing their language, they not knowing mine, and their sensitivity to what I wanted was one of the great experiences in my life.
Really?
It was
when
wonderful.
When did you start using the term environmental art?
Oh, right from the beginning. I recall what I did at the Grand Central Moderns, I think it was 1956 mm-hmm. or so, and they permitted me to throw out all the furniture.
Moon Garden Plus One.
Yeah, Moon Garden Plus One. And I took over the place and didn't permit anything to intrude on that environment, even changing the architecture by, taking one window and eliminating it by sculpture and so forth, so that the whole thing became of one piece. You see, when I do a exhibition, for instance, I do that exhibition the same way as I make a piece. So nothing, it has to be double the harmonious, or triple, or it's a multiplicity of the same as each piece is and relating to each other.
How did you get to wood as a medium?
Well, that was way back during the Second World War, and you couldn't get materials, and I didn't want to stop working. And somehow or another, it seemed to be a natural. Wherever I looked, there seemed to be sculpture in every piece of wood I saw. So I just followed a natural instinct, if there is such a thing. Let's put it better, a natural realization. And as I have said, that I've always trusted myself. If I felt that was right, then I did it. Of course, if we had more time, I'd tell you experiences about it. And most of the wood that I had for the first exhibition, of course, I got from Con Edison's on the street every time they fixed them.
Did they know that?
They didn't know, but I thought, oh, I hope no one from Con Edison's comes to my show.
They do lock the boxes now on the street. Though.
But now they have boxes and they lock their woods.
We know why.
Yes, but that was one. Then there was another experience. I took one of the horses from the street, and some policemen came along. And they said, that's a city property. What are you doing? And so I had to quickly think, and I said, well, I am a sculptor and I wanted to draw this piece. And they said, where do you live? And I told them. And so they said, well, we're going to come a little later to see. I said, well, don't come without a quart of whiskey. And they came with it. I always thought that was the funniest thing. And so I've had my little experiences. But I must say that for myself, the majority of my experiences in New York have been enlightening and pretty much of a joy, actually.
You are one of the busiest artists in the world. In fact, it's astonishing to me with the regularity that the work pours forth. But right now you're engaged not only in one of your most complex assignments, but certainly one of your most gratifying one, and that is the design of the sculpture, the architectural ornament, the vestments, the chapels for the new St. Peter's Church in the mixed-use development of the Citicorp building on 52nd and 53rd and Lexington Avenue. Tell us about that commission. It must be the dream of a lifetime to take on something like that.
Believe it or not, it's been like, what would you say, the frosting on a cake. After you've lived a life like I have, I don't think that anything that comes along is intimidating one. On the contrary, I think this has been a joyous marriage because of all the facets. But there isn't anything that I haven't experienced before. I mean, the vestments are pretty much like our collages, and all of it is of one piece, so that it is kind of remarkable that I find it so harmonious.
What is the chapel like?
Well, the chapel's going to be something. Yes, it's going to be.
When can we see that?
Well, no, it won't be finished for some time. I imagine it'll take about 8-9 more months. But don't forget, we've been working on it over a year. And
I also don't forget that all the while we're talking about joy and one wonderful, heady, and exciting experience after another, I don't forget, and no doubt you don't either, that for quite some time, the critics always admired your work, but for quite some time it seemed that the public did not think that your found object wood sculptures were either aesthetically or monetarily valuable. For a very long time. Mm-hmm. How did you manage to survive, to renew yourself for practically a 40-year period when it did not get the kind of response and you continued to work away?
Yes. Well, number one, let's not forget that the critics were marvelous right away. And of course, I was unhappy over certain things. You can be sure of that. But on the other hand, I knew pretty much what I was doing. As a matter of fact, I was sure of it. Because if you look in View magazine, way back in the 1940s, there was Calder's work and my work. I think it was 1942. So that I was well received as a modern sculptor in New York. So that fed me. Another thing, I realized that they didn't sell because, you know, this is a primitive country yet. It's a young country.
Didn't one of your dealers in Nierendorf tell you that, to leave this country at some point?
Yes, he did. He felt that my mind should have been in, say, in Paris, in France, where these different minds
were. This was in the early 40s, I assume.
Yes. But I, on the contrary, anyway, felt that I wanted to stay here, because if it was primitive, I felt like a pioneer that I was going to help this country to unfold, but I didn't finish before. So I knew old wood they weren't ready for. Of course, they recognized diamonds are valuable, gold is valuable, materials are valuable, but old wood is not valuable. On the other hand, don't forget that old wood has to be cleaned and nursed much more so than new wood, and it's a great effort. But then I'll go back again to what I was going to say. So they didn't buy it, but the critics always fed me, and you think I own, the New York Times, because all their critics have just been wonderful to me. And then the Emily Janauer, for 40-odd years, she recognized me in the 1930s. So I had the strength of where I thought it counted.
And you've also said that you always knew that you were a winner.
Yes.
How did you always know that you were an artist?
Well, I think that's born. How do you know you have blue eyes or black eyes? And not only that, I was fed by every art teacher from the time I went to school until I graduated, and I was the artist of Rockland at the time. I could say that, the one artist, if there was something to be done, they'd call on me. So they fed me, which makes me think. I just read in the book that I took from you, how do you pronounce it, Gurdjieff? how do you pronounce it?
Gurdjieff.
Yeah. Gurdjieff. He said in it, I just saw one line, that everything that happens to you in life happens from the outside. I thought and lived with the idea that everything that happens is that I project. So it's a different point of view.
What makes Dawns Plus Dusk such an interesting book is that it's for me as much about life and philosophy as it is about art. How did you ever come to know Louise Nevelson?
Oh my, that's a very long story. Louise had a wonderful assistant called Teddy Hazeltine.
You mentioned that.
Yes, and Teddy I met at a Hungarian baroness's house. It was an old friend of my family's. And Louise was, I think that summer or whatever, she was in the Venice Biennale. And he brought me down to the house and I took my cat and came down. And I stayed there. And I looked, when I got up in the morning, I looked at the work and I thought, oh my God, this is Louise Nevelson's house. And I said, Teddy, why didn't you tell me? And he said, oh, well, I live here. It's just my house, you know. He said, I know you'd find out sooner or later. And I said, I think I better go. Maybe she doesn't want me to be here. So a year went by. A year later, I was in Europe for a year. I lived in Italy, in Rome. And I came back and I called Teddy up. And Teddy said, why don't you come down to the house because we're playing poker? And I said, oh, are you alone? He said, oh, no. Louise is here and her sister and there's a bunch. And we love to gamble and you know, play poker. And I said, well, okay. So I came down and it was very strange because there were all these pennies, you know, everyone was putting these pennies in the middle of this table. And no matter what cards I'd get, if I got three kings, I'd throw them away, I'd get four aces. It got more embarrassing and I won everything on the table. It was just one of those strange things. And so very shortly after that, I sort of just moved in.
Well, to pay the book, please, Louise.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, you remember, you did your teacher, Mr. Albert.
Joseph Albers.
Yes, he did tell you about the work so that you were aware.
Oh, yes, I was indeed aware. But yes. Indeed,
to
I
refer
was, yes.
to what Diana said earlier, and meaning to pay the book a compliment, you've really hit the jackpot with Dawns Plus Dusk. Taped interviews with Louise Nevelson by Diana McCowan, a book that I warmly recommend to everyone. You reflected an amazing artist with her of a very special vision and a very special energy, and I thank you both for doing that. To our guest today, Louise Nevelson, and her accomplished interviewer, Diana McCowan. I'm Barbara Lee Diamondstein, and thank you for being with us. Ba 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 ba